When is an estuary not an estuary? Well, the answer lies in this beautiful body of water behind me. Where exactly am I? Join me in just a moment and I'll tell you.
They say it's what's on the inside that counts.
It certainly gets more interesting the more we've come through. Yeah.
You're definitely smiling a bit more now.
But can we also find outside space with features that please them?
I don't know if this is big enough for you, the garden.
I think maybe it is. And I've always wanted a pet rock.
Today we're in Devon and I'm on the south coast at the renowned Salcombe Estuary, which isn't really an estuary at all because there's no river that meets the incoming tide, just a number of small streams. It's an extreme example of a ria or a drowned river valley. But that's of no consequence to the locals and visitors who have flocked here for centuries to make this a favourite sailing hotspot.
Part of England's southwest peninsula, Devon's two coastlines are flanked by the Bristol Channel to the north and the English Channel to the south. Among the beautiful features of the southern seascape is Slapton Lea, the largest natural freshwater lake in the southwest region, separated from the sea by a shingle beach. As well as being a nature reserve, it's a protected site of special scientific interest. Seaton Bay forms part of the county stretch of Jurassic Coast. Designated an area of outstanding natural beauty, it's where the River Axe meets the sea. Axmouth was the most important harbour in the west of England from the Iron Age to the Middle Ages, when the mouth of the estuary was almost half a mile wide. Away from the coast, the vast expanse of Dartmoor has national park status. It's where the River Dart begins its journey, starting out as two separate rivers that join on the moor at Dartmeet. Flowing south to the sea, it passes the Benedictine Abbey in Buckfast, where since the 1880s, tonic wine has been produced by the monks. Dartmoor is also home to the native ponies who roam this terrain, which is well known for its distinctive granite rock formations. Hathor is linked to an old legend about an unhappy bride who leapt from these high rocks, but whose life was saved by her wedding dress, which acted as a parachute. The story has a happy ending, as she went on to marry her true love. So for those seeking a happy ever after in the midst of dramatic landscapes, Devon could be the perfect destination.
With its stunning and varied mix of land and seascapes, it's no wonder that the average cost of a detached home here in Devon is £30,000 above the national figure. But if it's the beautiful south coastal town of Salcombe that takes your fancy, well, you're going to add around £200,000 to that figure because it's the second most expensive seaside town in the UK. Head further inland away from the national parks and your money will go further. But it's that blend of countryside and coast that's appealing to today's couple, and they're hoping to find a home that allows them to take advantage of the region's popular tourist industry. So let's meet them.
Rosie, who works for the prison service, and Sandy, who works for an environment agency, first got to know each other through a dating website 10 years ago. But it was only after finding out that they had mutual friends they finally decided to meet in person and quickly realised they shared the same sense of humour.
We decided we'd play a prank on our friends, so we said that we really hadn't got along and that it was a real nightmare. And I just said, oh, she was just really dull. How did you ever think that we'd get on? We did have a giggle with that one, yeah, because they were just mortified.
I was getting texts through saying, I'm so sorry, really thought you'd like each other. And so the rest is history.
Yes, definitely. That's, yes, getting on 7 years ago.
Their relationship has developed despite being tied to different places for work. Rosie's in the city of Bath, Somerset, and Sandy near Swansea, Wales, so they're still living in separate homes.
Neither of our houses are suitable for us to live in together.
The house in Swansea is too small for us to live together peaceably. The house in Bath is lovely, but it's not big enough for our needs, and the road is really noisy. There isn't any way you can go to have space.
Watching Star Trek is a nightmare.
It is, watching Star Trek is a nightmare.
if you don't like
it. If you don't like it.
However, they're both winding up their current jobs and have decided it's time for a new chapter together. This means marriage and buying their first joint home.
When Sandy asked me to marry her, I think it was the night that I'd had two gin and tonics rather than the normal one, so I can't quite remember saying yes, but I'm sure that I did. And so now we're officially engaged, and we're getting married, and we're going to combine our resources and buy our perfect home.
It's great. It's like having, it's like, yeah, a whole new future's opened
yes.
up, isn't it?
Yeah, very exciting time at the moment, very, very exciting.
There's one place they've both decided they would like to be.
We want somewhere quieter. The area that we've sort of thought of moving to is the Devon area. You could go very easily to the moors because we're both keen gardeners, so good growing conditions. We want to be able to get in with a community that is really involved and, you know, sort of everybody's pulling together for the village and lots of things going
on. Growing beans, making jam.
Swapping beans.
Yes. Making wine.
Stroking chickens.
Stroking chickens, yeah,
that
yeah.
sort of thing.
Yeah. Most of all, they're looking forward to being in the same part of the country with time for each other.
Because we're always dashing, we spend so much time travelling and things, it's just going to be really nice to have the time.
I'd like the idea of slow weekends, you know, cooking food, having guests over. Yes, we're really looking forward to our life together, aren't we? The things that a lot of people take for granted, I think, just the simple things, yes.
Sandy and Rosie are keen to live in the south of the county, close to moorland and coast. So that's where we're meeting to discuss what they'd like from their new home.
Well, welcome to Devon, the two of you.
Hello.
Hello.
And what about this particular area? Because you're very keen on one specific part, aren't you?
Yeah, I think accessibility to South Devon, it's popular, it's beautiful. You've got the contrast of the sea and the moors. Yeah, it couldn't do better.
Yeah.
We've decided we're going to get married at the end of the year.
Yep.
So, Devon, here we come.
So which is more scary, the wedding or the move?
The wedding.
We can't help you with the wedding.
The move.
OK, the move we can help you. No, so let's talk about your dream house. What do you envisage?
We want quite a big house.
You know, we're both keen gardeners, so, you know, a good piece of land, but, you know, a workshop and, you know, sort of something to keep me busy.
It doesn't have to be perfect to start with. We're quite happy to do some work.
Yep.
I'd like four bedrooms and I'd like an ensuite, if possible, to the master bedroom. It would have at least two reception rooms. It would have a big kitchen. I love cooking.
I don't.
And... well, we'd like an annex, wouldn't we?
Yeah.
Some kind of a building that maybe could be converted. We quite like the idea of doing some kind of hospitality, maybe a holiday let, or, you know, just having the option to have that bit of extra room.
Yeah.
What about the location? Are you keen to be very rural? Do you want neighbours? Do you want to be part of the community?
Not too keen on having too close a neighbours.
No road noise.
Yeah.
Absolute must. No road noise.
OK, so definite peace and quiet. Yeah. Well, you've got quite a wish list for this search, so remind me of the budget that we're working with.
Our budget is £5,525.
Yeah.
Well, you'll be very pleased to hear that we've got three beautiful properties to show you. Well, it's an exciting search. Mm. I'm raring to go. I don't know about the two of you.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Let's go.
OK.
For their budget of £525,000, Rosie and Sandy are looking for a large house with a good bit of land, and they don't mind taking on some work. They want four bedrooms, including an ensuite, a big kitchen, and the option of an annex. Finally, it should be in a secluded location with no road noise. We've lined up three fantastic options to show them, all offering a different take on their wish list. At each, they'll be guessing the price before I reveal it. And the final house will be a mystery property, which could prove to be just too perfect.
So this is going to be your very first home together. Do you think you're bringing different characteristics to the search than the two of you?
Yes, I'm looking for more the practical things like the kitchen and view. It's
outside space.
It's outside, yeah.
And I get a sense from you, Sandy, as well, that, you know, actually knocking down walls, possibly even rebuilding a place, that wouldn't be too much for you.
No, I'm quite happy to do lots of work. I'm happiest when I'm knocking things about. I like to build things. I like to create things. And I'm more than happy to get it sorted.
Yeah, give her a problem and she'll solve it.
Yeah.
Lovely. It's time to go and look at a house.
Yes. Yes.
Are you excited?
It's time to go and look at a house.
We are.
Our search is starting out in Scorriton, a tiny village in the Dartmoor National Park. Just a mile away, the slightly larger moorland village of Holme is surrounded by country lanes. It's home to a handy community-run shop and tea room. The Reverend Charles Kingsley, Victorian author of The Water Babies, was born here, whilst the medieval inn was a filming location for the Spielberg movie War Horse. Back in Scorriton, in the centre of the village, is house number one.
Right, I'm going to stop you here because there to my right is the property that we wanted to show you.
Wow, it looks big.
It looks pretty.
It's picture perfect, isn't it, really?
Pretty.
Do you want to look inside?
Oh, yes,
come on, let me lead on.
OK.
Built from local stone, this detached cottage dates back to around 1850 and has been sympathetically modernised over the years, whilst retaining its period charm. A porched entrance leads to a hall and onto a country kitchen diner at the back of the home.
Very nice.
So we've got an interesting layout down here. It's on a couple of different levels. We've got this cosy kitchen with its range and its beautiful old beams. Through there is the living room. Again, there's oak floors, beams. We've got a great granite, big roaring fireplace with a log burner. And then there's a sunroom just off to the back. So it's a nice flow down here.
I like the range. Yeah, nice with the dining kitchen and the separate utility.
It's not fully open plan, but there's definitely a sense of connection between the spaces.
Yeah. Maybe a little bit small, but certainly, you know, I could work with it.
I'm quite keen to show you upstairs and show you the bedrooms.
Okay.
So a mixed response to the ground floor of this pretty Dartmoor cottage. Through the utility, there's a further surprise I'm keeping up my sleeve. But first, I want to show them the three bedrooms this home provides upstairs. To the rear, a pleasant guest double enjoys views over the Dartmoor countryside. Whilst a second guest room to the front of the home is currently used as a study. There's a family bathroom, once again with lovely views. And then another double bedroom at the front that could be Rosie and Sandy's.
What do you think?
Nice room, nice and bright and light.
We have a huge bed, and actually, if we put our bed in here, there wouldn't be much other space.
Yeah.
You know, cottages are small, but I think it's smaller than I had imagined.
The rooms were not built and planned with today's dimensions in mind.
No. There's always compromises to make, and we realise that.
Yeah.
It's, you know, what you compromise on.
There is one bedroom that I haven't shown you yet that does have quite a large bed in it.
Okay.
So I'll say no more at this point, other than if you let me squeeze through the middle of you, just follow on and all will be revealed.
Okay.
Okay.
The surprise twist I'm waiting to reveal is that this three-bedroom home also comes with a generous, attached one-bedroom annex arranged over two floors. With private access via the utility area, the good-sized bedroom of this bonus addition is found on the ground floor.
Ah!
Oh, okay. Oh, wow.
Straight into the bedroom. Is that big enough?
I think that's big enough,
It's a good-sized room.
Yeah.
Well, we're not going to linger in here, because the beauty of this is it's completely self-contained on two stories.
On the ground floor, the annex also has its own shower room, whilst the upper floor provides a kitchenette and living space.
Oh, this is good, yeah.
It's a good size. Okay. You've got a real lovely sense of airiness in here.
It certainly gets more interesting the more we've come through.
Yeah.
You're definitely smiling a bit more now.
Yeah.
It's already being rented as a very successful business. Mm. And it's very busy right the year round.
Mm. The more I'm seeing a bit, the more I'm liking it.
Yeah. The owners were saying to me, though, that when sort of Christmas comes, they don't take bookings on it. They close it off, and that's when it really comes into its own, when they've got family coming to stay and the grandchildren.
Yes. It makes it much more flexible. Yeah.
So good. Well, I can see a real lift in both of you, and you can understand now what you know, we thought the appeal of this would be. Now, I know the garden matters to you, and that's one thing we haven't seen. So let's go out and wander then. Then I'm going to have to ask you to guess the price, so do a bit of thinking.
OK.
The added bonus of a self-contained annex offering rental income or additional space for visitors has us leaving the interior of this cottage on a high. And outside, in that all-important garden, there are secluded spots to take in the views of the rolling Dartmoor Hills. There's a stone shed with power and lighting which is attached to the home. A vegetable plot is already established, along with mature fruit trees and flower borders. There's no denying it's an attractive garden, but the question is it big enough?
For me, it's too small.
Yeah.
OK.
I would be stir-crazy with once I've hoovered the lawn.
Yeah, I think I'd have to agree that we need to do things and have projects and areas that we can change and move around, and I think here we'd run out of things within a year to do, so...
Okay. OK, well, let's see if the price convinces you one way or the other on this house. So, who wants to go first?
Probably 435.
OK, so your budget's 525,000. You're going quite a way under there, Sandy.
I would say more. I would say 475.
It is under budget, and it's somewhere between the two of you. It's on the market for £465,000.
Oh, right, OK.
I was closest.
You were very close, so that you do get the mark. You get the brownie point today.
One star.
I think it's a lovely house and a nice garden.
Interesting.
And,
I can see why you picked it, because of the annex, and it's fabulous, so... Mm.
Go in, take a good look around, get that mental sledgehammer out, and come and find me when you've seen enough.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, I think that's been a really interesting first viewing, and it showed me that they really are open to suggestions and open to change, but I have a feeling that the size of this garden is just a bit of a deal-breaker.
Coming in at £60,000 under their budget, this detached period cottage has a country kitchen diner and provides three bedrooms in the main house, plus a further one-bedroom self-contained annex. It's in a central village location, and there are beautiful views of the surrounding Dartmoor countryside.
Well, this is interesting. What would we do with this?
Knock it into the kitchen, I think.
Yeah?
Skylights, make a lovely space.
Yeah, it would. It's just a quintessential village property, lovely wisteria outside, very attractive, lovely house.
I loved the annex. That was a real surprise, and for me, that was the nicest part of the house. A good veggie plot there.
Yeah, nice.
Oh, poor plum tree.
Yeah. Too heavy.
The polytunnel's good.
Yeah, it is. The garden outside, unfortunately, just not quite making it for us, I don't think, just too small.
I think when you go into a house, you know immediately whether it's yours, whether it fits you, and I don't think that one does.
If we were living here, it would probably be me. I don't think Sandy would be with me.
Just admiring this little English cottage garden here at the front. It's pretty.
Yes, it's lovely, isn't it?
Very pretty, yes.
Well, that was our lovely country cottage. I think we're off to a really good start.
OK.
But there's still more to see. Come on.
Devon's fertile terrain and pleasant climate make it a horticultural haven. The county is home to acres of beautiful gardens, many of which are open to the public. The natural surroundings here also serve as inspiration for a thriving artistic community who find creative ways to capture and express the beauty of Devon's varied landscapes. Today we've arranged for gardening enthusiasts Rosie and Sandy to meet artist Pauline Lee to discover how she combines her love of natural flora in her Dartmoor garden with her clay and ceramic work.
So, was it a conscious decision to make nature your inspiration?
I think I've always been a nature lover.
Yes.
You know, because I'm doing something that's sculptural, I look for sculptural sort of forms. Oh, okay. So, you know, it's the seed heads, the trees, the bark. If I'm sitting here, I might just finding various shapes, might be in between the plants and things like that. Let's go for a walk. Let's see what we can find.
Lovely.
Rosie and Sandy will be creating their very own art pieces in clay. And the first step is foraging for natural forms in the garden.
We're looking for any interesting textures and shapes. You know, like a little bit like that would work really well. Have a look around, see what you can find.
OK, we will. Thank you.
I think this is the leaf I like the look of. I cut a bit of that one.
Yeah.
Yes, I could see that. Now, that would work, wouldn't it?
I hate cutting them. And I wondered about a piece of that.
Yeah.
That's so delicate. Yeah.
What do you think about that?
Yeah, yeah.
After gathering a variety of samples, it's time to head to the studio and make their very own clay tiles.
Range it on your tile, face down,
yeah,
gently, press in your petals into the clay.
Using paper and a rolling pin, the plant pieces are pressed into the wet tiles. Known as crank clay, it won't shrink much and will be weatherproof once it's fired.
Not pastry.
Carefully peel the paper off.
Oh, yeah, wow.
Leave,
wow.
Yeah, and it'll leave the... Wow. Leaving the plant material in there.
The tiles are dried off using a hairdryer before being painted with a slip glaze. The clay's high iron content will cause it to blacken in the heat of the furnace, so enough white glaze needs to be applied to ensure the design will be visible.
You want to get a good coating of the white, mm-hmm. otherwise the black will come through a bit strong. So just a bit more, just lay it on.
Then it's time to reveal nature's imprint as the plant material is carefully removed.
Wow.
Oh, look at that.
Wow.
The little bits left in, can I pick those out?
No, because they'll actually burn out in the kiln. They'll burn to nothing. Yeah.
And the completed tiles are ready to go into the heated kiln for around 24 hours.
I'm well pleased with that. Excellent.
Well done.
Thank you.
Thank you, yes. That's great.
Having turned their hand to producing something creative, it's time to see if our houses can produce the goods as our journey continues. We're heading to Ponsworthy, a tiny hamlet in the heart of Dartmoor. Situated in the West Webburn Valley, the hamlets Ford and Clapper Bridge Crossing are known locally as The Splash. It's a wild, rugged area popular with walkers and paddlers. The nearby confluence of the East and West Dart Rivers at Dartmeet is the location of a 17th century bridge and is a start point for kayakers and canoeists. The hamlet itself consists of just a few buildings, many centuries old, and the property we've come to see is no exception.
Oh, wow. That's more like it.
I think your faces say it all for me.
And I brought you to see not one, but sort of two properties in one.
OK.
So they were the old wheelwright and the old bakers for the village.
Right.
So this one, this stone barn conversion, is the bakehouse.
Oh, OK.
And over there is the wheelhouse, all nestled within 2 acres of land as well. So there's a...
land!
Do you really want to have a look?
Yeah,
you sure?
No.
Okay. Push me in the door.
Go, come on.
Okay.
When this property was converted in the 1970s, it won several architectural awards. The bakery part forms the heart of the house. The front door leads straight into this characterful and cosy reception room, which includes a 7-foot granite bread oven.
Wow.
Oh, that's a nice little room,
yes,
isn't it?
Right.
That's a cracking window.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's lovely. Oh, wow. Yes.
It's got that incredible bread oven there at the back of the fireplace. If you got a door for the front there, you could still use it for baking bread.
Okay.
And this is actually a bit of an upside-down house, so follow me and I'm going to start explaining the layout to you.
A central hall leads past a ground floor bathroom and a useful WC to the other end of the house. And this is where the first and largest of the main home's 2 bedrooms is.
Very
it's
an
nice.
Interesting house, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. I think what's been really clever about this house is how you can see the bones of what it was.
Yes.
It's still really apparent that this was a working building once.
Yeah.
It's got all its character.
Yeah.
But it's definitely big enough for a very big deck.
Yeah, big enough for a good size
bed,
yes.
For sure, for sure.
Main living and dining space is upstairs, so let's go up and take a look.
Okay.
So a good fit for Rosie and Sandy on the ground floor. And back in the central hall, stairs lead up into an open-plan living space that includes the kitchen.
So I hope you're ready for a bit of open-plan living.
Oh, right.
That's very nice, isn't it?
I like it.
Yeah,
like
so do
it?
I.
It's really quirky.
I like it a lot.
It's a great space. It feels lovely.
Yeah.
You've got this for your most sociable, relaxed open space.
Yeah. How's the kitchen for you, Diane?
Yes. Yes, the kitchen's looking fine, thank you. Yeah, I think I could work in there. Yeah.
Completing the upstairs, there's a second bedroom with a study leading off it that could perhaps be turned into an ensuite bathroom or walk-in wardrobe. But with such a positive response to the main home, I can't wait to show them the one-bedroom annex, where a small lobby leads into the main living and cooking area.
So come on in. This is property number two.
This is lovely.
It was a wheelwright's and a carpenter's shop. It's got everything you need to rent it out as an annex if you wanted to.
Yeah. I think it's really cute. Nice.
Yeah.
Absolutely. It's got a lot of potential.
Huge amount of potential. Yeah.
A
little bit of work, which is good.
Yeah.
What's really interesting, and knowing how, Sandy, you love to, you know, knock down walls and get stuff in, is there's another floor under this, which is used as a huge storeroom workshop at the moment. Okay. So there's also the potential with the right planning permission to really convert this into a second home, really.
I can see your eyes widening.
this is great.
Now, I did mention something at the start, and that was the fact that this has got 2 acres of land with it. Are you keen to have a look at that?
Absolutely.
OK, let's go outside and just explore it. There's a lot to see, as you can imagine.
Yes.
Completing the accommodation in the annex is a good-sized bedroom and bathroom. They like what I've shown them so far, and outside there's even more accommodation, with a converted piggery that's now a studio with a log-burning stove to help keep it cosy through the winter months. Most of the land is sloping pasture used for grazing, with granite outcrops, woodland, and access down to the river.
I don't know if this is big enough for you, the garden.
I think maybe it is. And I've always wanted a pet rock.
Yes. It's flat top, look at it. Yeah. It's beautiful, absolutely stunning. And river.
Very, very exciting as a prospect, isn't it? Incredible.
You find anything to fault with it?
No.
It absolutely ticks all the boxes.
We've got one important box left to tick, and that's the price. So what do you think it's on the market for?
I'm going to say this is 515.
Well, it's got a lot to offer. I would probably go a bit over budget, and I would probably say 535.
Are you going to meet in the middle? Because if you did meet in the middle, you'd be bang
on.
Yeah. It's bang on budget.
Oh, wow.
It's about £525,000.
Okay.
Why don't you go off and explore, take a really good look around and come and find me when you're ready.
Okay. Love
Thank
to.
You.
Thank you. See you later.
I'm so pleased that these two have had such an amazing reaction to this property, and I think Sandy, she just can't wait to get started with it.
Right on budget, this former bakery and wheelwrights gives them two properties in one. A main house with open-plan kitchen living space and two bedrooms, plus a self-contained one-bedroom annex with scope for further conversion. There are 2 acres of mixed land, and it's all in the heart of the Dartmoor National Park.
Oh, wow.
Herbs, look, overgrown herb comfrey.
Yeah. And then the fruit cage is here. Oh, yes. Excellent.
Nice little seating spot.
Yeah.
When we turned into the gateway, I was very pleasantly surprised. It was exactly the sort of property that I was looking for. It was just lovely, absolutely lovely.
You could move straight in here, clearly, but if you wanted to change things, upgrade things, add to it, you certainly could.
The annex, it's solid, you know, the structure is sound, but there is huge potential there to make it beautiful. The original features in there are incredible.
It's a quirky kind of property, and it's just the kind of place Sandy and I would be looking for. Definitely.
So could this be the house to keep you two busy? Which I think is what you really want from this move, isn't it?
I think so, yes.
I think it might. Yes. Just do the shake.
Well, don't say anything too soon, because we've got another day tomorrow, and of course we've got the mystery house to see.
Wow.
Today we're in South Devon, helping intrepid couple Rosie and Sandy find their first home together, with a budget of £525,000. They've already seen two great properties, which sparked some thoughts, but there's still the mystery house to come, which prompts some straight talking.
This would keep you busy for a little while.
Would it keep you busy enough?
No.
Plus, I'm finding out what floats the locals' boat in Devon's coastal waters.
So have you got your own generation to hand it on to? Yeah, have you got
them
waiting?
Little kids. They're out here from 2 weeks old, so...
Fantastic, it's in the blood.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, it's the second day of our house search here in Devon, and I think we ended yesterday on a high note with that second property that just really seemed to appeal to Sandy and Rosie. And let's face it, there was certainly enough land to keep them busy for quite a while. But I can't help but think that they're sacrificing some of the personal space that I know these two would really like in order to find that annex. So for the mystery house, well, we're going to challenge them on that and just show them a beautiful home for the two of them. Because let's not forget that this is the first house that they will actually have jointly owned together. The question is, though, will just a home be enough for these two? So what do you think I'm going to throw at you this morning with the mystery house?
Well, if the mystery house is a challenge and it's semi-detached, that would be a challenge.
Yes. Yeah, definite curveball.
And if it had a courtyard garden, that would certainly be a challenge.
I don't know. Maybe something modern or maybe thatched or... I don't know. Okay. We're looking forward to it. We think you might be little tinkers and throw anything at us.
Well, you're right about that. We are capable of throwing most things at our buyers.
A mystery offering is located in the hamlet of Idston. Lying within the South Hams district of the county, the village of Lodderswell is less than a mile away. This once wealthy wool settlement is home to a useful post office and stores, a 14th century granite church, and of course a local pub. Back in Idston, the mystery house enjoys a very peaceful rural location and is a former farm building.
So it's a barn conversion.
Right. Yeah.
It's one of four conversions that were done here. And it is attached, but really it has a very detached feel about it. You're not really that aware of your neighbours.
So it's this building.
It's this building. That's one of your neighbours there, just behind the fence.
Right.
And then there's the really pretty courtyard garden.
OK.
Right. Yeah.
Why we've wanted to show you this is it is an absolutely beautiful home. Mm. There is no annex with this property.
Right.
But this is more of a place for you two to come and live, to enjoy, to relax, to go out and do things.
OK. Yes, I'm liking the sound.
I had a feeling, Rosie, this might appeal to you. I don't think you're going to need to think about sledgehammers in this one. Okay. Rosie's got a smile on her face. Come on.
Thought to date to around the 19th century, the stone barn was converted into a three-storey home back in the 1990s, with a front door that opened straight into a large living space on the ground floor, including an open-plan kitchen.
Oh, this is nice. Yes, I can see myself in that kitchen.
Yes. Mm. No, yes, it's a lovely room.
So you're thinking this is a lovely room, but there's nothing for me to do, and you're thinking, great, this is nothing lovely for me to do apart from cook and enjoy.
Yes, exactly. I could cook and enjoy in here.
Well, it is a lovely room, and it has been beautifully done. You know, the quality of the work, the space here is good, but out of here I'm seeing buildings that are other people's.
OK, why don't we go and take a look upstairs?
You'd love to. Okay.
The ground floor also features a handy cloakroom, along with a shower room. Upstairs, the middle floor provides a second living space.
So here you go, this is the second sitting room.
Okay.
Which I think would be your cosy winter sitting room.
Oh, yes.
It's lovely.
Yes.
Yes. I like it. Yes, it's nice.
Yes, it's a lovely room.
Good. I want to show you the bedrooms. The master bedroom is right next door, and there's two more up on the top. So let's go and take a look at the master bedroom.
Okay.
Thanks. So here we go.
Oh, yes.
And it is definitely a room with a view.
It's it. Look. Yeah, look at that view.
Yes, it's a good bedroom.
You've got a beautiful ensuite. And again, it's just got that really nice, light, airy feel that is often quite unusual with period properties.
From what we've seen so far, the house is spot on. The rooms we've seen are great and offering just what we want.
Well, listen, let's go and take a look outside, because there is the courtyard garden, but I've been keeping something else up my sleeve, so follow me.
The interior is definitely scoring highly with Rosie. Up again, on the top floor, there are two further double bedrooms, one of which is currently used as a study, whilst bedroom number three has beautiful views over the surrounding countryside. The three bedrooms on this floor are both served by a family bathroom. But with Sandy keen to find projects to keep her busy, I'm hoping that the third of an acre of garden will address that. The sloping lawn includes a variety of fruit trees, a timber shed, and an intriguing outbuilding that acts as a pump house for all the homes in these converted barns.
So you do get land with the property as well.
This would keep you busy for a little while.
Would it keep you busy enough?
No.
Okay.
If we wanted somewhere to move straight into, and if we were just looking for a home, I think we'd be pushed to find anywhere, you know, nicer from the internal aspect and the way that it's done.
The kitchen is absolutely spot on.
Yes, but there are close neighbours.
Let's just see if the price has any influence on this, because we have to return to that subject. So what do you both think it's on the market for? Who wants to go first?
I think it's on at 495.
OK, Sandy?
I think it's probably less than that. Oh.
OK.
I think it's probably 465.
Ah, interesting. Both of you are on this occasion wrong.
No surprises there.
But on this occasion, Sandy, you are closest.
Ah.
OK. But it's actually on the market for less than both of you have said. It's on the market for £450,000.
OK. Very interesting.
Yes, very interesting.
Well, I'm going to leave you with that thought.
OK.
Go in, take a look, explore inside. Yeah. Come and find me when you're ready.
Okay. OK.
I did have my doubts about whether just a home, albeit a very beautiful one, would be enough for this couple. And I don't think it is.
A substantial £75,000 under budget, our impeccable mystery barn conversion offers three-storey living with an open-plan feel. It provides three double bedrooms, including the master ensuite, and a third of an acre garden with countryside views.
Nice room. Nice room, yeah.
Easily another bedroom.
Yes.
It is beautifully done.
I like the property. It's got a nice look about it.
My most important thing is outside space, and it was obvious that that was compromised by neighbours. It's a beautiful property, and maybe 10 years down the line, you know, it would be nice to have somebody, if I fell over, I could call, but not at the moment.
For me, just having a home would be quite attractive because it would leave time to spend our time doing other things. But for Sandy, she needs to have a project. She would be impossible without work to do.
I'm not quite ready for, you know, inactivity as yet.
I'm just enjoying the peace and quiet in this lovely garden that doesn't need anything doing to it.
Exactly.
Well, we've seen all the properties now, so I think it's time to do some talking.
Aye.
The southwest is home to numerous historic harbours and estuaries, which are a draw for experienced seafarers and enthusiasts alike. In these waters, you'll see a huge range of sailing craft. Local geographical features and maritime heritage have inevitably shaped the designs of the more traditional vessels. In Foy, Cornwall, a sailing yacht known as the Troy class was developed in the 1920s by local boat builder Archie Watty. To this day, each one must be built by hand within the Foy estuary. Elsewhere in Cornwall, the Red Wing sailing dinghy has been a fixture for over seven decades. Whilst in Dorset, the Lyme Regis Boat Building Academy is still producing handcrafted boats like this guillemot made from chestnut and larch. But here in Salcombe, it's all about the Salcombe yawl. So I'm meeting local boatman and yawl enthusiast Tristan Stone to find out about the enduring appeal of these little wooden sailing boats.
Hi, how are you?
Good, thanks. They're beautiful looking boats, but what's the history of the Salcombe yawl?
It evolved many years ago from a fishing boat, and now they're very keenly raced on the estuary.
I guess the clue is in the name Salcombe, and that leads me to say, is it just around here that you find them? So they're quite unique to this area.
That's right. They only really race here. There is a Devon yawl, but it's fiberglass, this is all wood.
The features of the Kingsbridge estuary, including the beautiful Salcombe Bay, led to the development of the yawl in the late 18th century. With rich pickings of crab and lobster here, fishermen wanted to be able to lay and gather pots and needed an agile craft to navigate the waters.
And what's your involvement with them?
We look after over 40 of the Salcombe yawls. We varnish them, repair them.
But I bet they really come to life when you get them out on the water.
Yeah, definitely. Why don't we go and have a look?
The position of the coast here creates choppy waters, so the original yawls had to be able to sail out against the tide from the Salcombe estuary and be operated single-handedly. These are features that continue in the yawl to this day.
Here's a Salcombe yawl.
And I guess they were really designed with these waters in mind.
That's right. You've got the mizzen sail at the back, designed to stem the tide, because it was initially used for fishing, so you could shoot your crab pots or your fishing lines in a straight line. You've got a lifting keel, so where it's very shallow in areas, you can lift that up to be able to sail up the creek. You get huge tide races around here, so you need a good boat to get out to shoot your pots or get your catch and come back in. You've also got the notorious Salcombe Bar here, which gets very rough in the winter, and you need a stable boat to come back in over that.
But it's interesting that those idiosyncrasies on the yawl that you just talked about have actually meant that it's been able to make that transition from being a working boat, a fishing boat, to one that people use for fun, for pleasure and for racing in.
Yeah, we're really lucky that the estuary's carried on its tradition and the Salcombe yawls have now got decks so people can sail them. There's about between 40 and 60 that race in Regatta Week, and hopefully it will carry on for generations.
So have you got your own generation to hand it on to? Yeah,
have you got two little kids. They're out here from 2 weeks old, so...
Fantastic, it's in the blood.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, we're near the end of a voyage of discovery for a Devon home for Rosie and Sandy. So let's see if any of our properties have been on the right course.
Well, we've had a great house hunt here in Devon, and it's time to see where the land lies. Although, to be honest, I've got a pretty good idea what these two are going to say. Well, what a nice spot to end our search here in Devon in.
Absolutely.
It's lovely, isn't it?
It is, beautiful. Yes.
I'm going to take a wild stab in the dark at this point that one house might have stood out for the two of you.
Yes.
Yeah, sharp.
Oh, I catch on quickly.
Yes, house number two was definitely a contender.
Yeah. Yes, yeah.
I think it was the possibilities there. And it just had a really nice feel to it,
yeah,
didn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. I think we could see ourselves there.
Yeah, I don't think we could fault it.
So will you be taking any next steps with the twin barn conversions?
Well, it's a definite contender, and I think we'd want to be going and having another look.
Yep.
And making a decision then.
Do you feel excited? Do you feel like you're one step further along this journey to you both being down here together in your own home?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Most definitely, yes. Yeah. You've really helped us. Thank you.
Well, I really hope that that house does become your home, because I can just picture the two of you in it. I could see you both there. But whatever happens, you know, we wish you a lot of happiness down here, not just with your move to Devon, but also in this first home together.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Right at the start of our house hunt, Sandy and Rosie said that they liked the idea of having a project to work on. And what's become clear to me this week is that they actually need it, because these two are not ready to slow down. And I really hope that property number two becomes the home to keep them busy here in beautiful Devon. Join me next time on Escape to the Country.
If you would like to escape to the country in England, Wales, Scotland or Northern Ireland and need our help, you can apply online at bbc.co.uk/beonashow.